Hello and welcome back. I'm starting with a new topic from page number 20. To begin with, first of all, let us note down one question. That is, discuss about the residence of early humans in caves and open air sites. So let us see. Between 4 lakh and 1 lakh 25,000 years ago, caves and open air sites began to be used. Evidences of these comes from sites in Europe. In the Lazaret Cave in South France, a 12 by 4 meter shelter was built against the wall or the cave wall. Inside it were two herds, and evidences of different food sources was also found, like fruits, vegetables, seeds, nuts, bird's eggs and freshwater fish. At another site, that is in Terra Amata on the coast of southern France, Filmsy, that is a very weak looking shelter, was prepared with roofs of wood and grasses. And this was built for short term, or we can say seasonal visits. Now here, pieces of baked clay and burnt bone along with stone tools dated between 1.4 and 1 million years ago have been found at Chesawania, Kenya and Swartkans, that is in South Africa. Now the question is, were these the result of natural bushfire or volcanic eruptions? Or were they produced through the deliberate controlled use of fire? We do not know really. Now herds, on the other hand, are indications of the controlled use of fire. These had several advantages. Fire provided warmth and light inside caves and could also be used for cooking. Besides this, fire was used to harden wood. As for caves, you can see the tip of the spear was made hardened by the use of fire. The use of heat was facilitated the flaking of tools, making the tools. And then it was also important that for scaring away the dangerous animals from their caves and place of residence. Early humans making tools is our new topic. Let us note down a question for this topic. Give a brief description of making and use of tools by the early humans. It is useful to remember that the use of tools and tool making are not confined to humans. Birds are known to make objects to assist them with feeding, hygiene, and social encounters. And while searching for food, some chimpanzees use tools that they have been or that they have made. There are some features of human tool making that are not known among apes. As we had seen, certain anatomical and neurological adaptation have led to the skilled use of hands, probably due to the important role of tools in human lives. Moreover, the ways in which humans use and make tools often require greater memory and complex organizational skills, both of which are absent in apes. The earliest evidence of making and use of stone tools comes from the sites in Ethiopia and Kenya. It is likely that the earliest stone tool makers were the Australopithecus. We do not know whether tool making was done by men or women or both. It is possible that stone tool makers were both men and women. Women in particular may have made and used tools to obtain food for themselves as well as to sustain their children after weaning. About 35,000 years ago, improvements in the techniques for killing animals are evident from the appearance of new kinds of tools such as spear throwers and the bow and arrow. The meat thus obtained was probably processed by removing bones, followed by drying, smoking, and storing. Thus, food could be stored for later consumption. There were other changes such as the trapping of fur-bearing animals to use the fur for clothing and the invention of sewing needles. The earliest evidence of sewn clothing comes from the 21,000 years ago. Besides, with the introduction of the punch blade technique to make small chisel-like tools, it was now possible to make engravings on both antler, ivory, or wood. let us move on to our new topic, that is modes of communication, language and art. Note down the question: how has language developed? When did the spoken language emerge? Among living beings, it is humans alone that have a language. There are several views on language development. Number one is that hominid language involved gestures or hand movements. Point number two is that spoken language was preceded by vocal but non-verbal communication such as singing or humming. Point number three is that human speech probably began with calls like the ones that have been observed among primates. Human may have possessed a small number of speech sound in the initial stage. Gradually, these may have been developed into language. It has been suggested that the brain of Homo habilis had certain features which would have made it possible for them to speak. Thus, language may have developed as early as 2 million years ago. The evolution of the vocal tract was equally important. This occurred around 2 lakh years ago. It is most specifically associated with modern humans. A third suggestion is that language developed around the same time as the art. It is around 40 to 35,000 years ago. The development of spoken language has been closely connected with art, since both are media for communication. Let us move on to a new paragraph on page number 23 of the textbook. Once again, note down the question that follows. In which caves of France and Spain paintings of animals have been found? Why these were done? Hundreds of paintings of animals have been discovered in the caves of Lascaux and Chauvet, both in France, and Altamira in Spain. These include depictions of bison, horses, ibex, deer, mammoths, rhinos, lions, bears, panthers, hyenas, and owls. But some questions have been raised as to why these paintings were done. Several explanations have been offered. One is that because of the importance of hunting, the paintings of animals were associated with rituals and magic. The act of painting could have been a ritual to ensure a successful hunt. Another explanation offered is that these caves were possibly meeting places for small groups of people or locations for group activities. These groups could share hunting techniques and knowledge, while paintings and engravings served as the media for passing information from one generation to the next. Let us see the next topic. It is early encounters and hunter-gatherers in Africa. In this topic, we will be talking about the Hadza group of hunters. A question can be asked. Take note of it. What do you know about the Hadza group of people? The Hadza are small group of hunters and gatherers living in the wind city of Lake Ayashi, a salt rift valley lake. Many wild animals are found in these area: elephant, rhinos, buffaloes, giraffe, zebra, waterbuck, gazelle, waterhog, baboon, lion, leopard, and hyena. These all are common. Other are small animals which are also found, such as porcupine, hare, jackal, tortoise, and many other. All of these animals, apart from elephant, are hunted and eaten by the Hadza group of people. The amount of meat that could be regularly eaten without endangering the future of the game is probably greater than anywhere else. Sources of water are widely distributed over the country in the wet season, but are very few in the dry season. So the size and location of their area depends on the availability of water and water sources. The Hadza people never assert rights over land and its resources because they could live wherever they like and they hunt wherever they want. Hunter-gatherer society from the present to the past is the last topic of the chapter. Let us begin with a question. Can the information about present hunter societies be used to understand the past societies? There are two opposing views on the issue whether the information about living hunters and gatherers could be easily or could be used to understand the past societies. Let us see the views. First, there are scholars who have directly applied specific data from present-day hunter-gatherer societies to interpret the archaeological remains of the past. Some archaeologists have suggested that the hominid sites are dated to 2 million years ago along the Lake Turkana, might be a dry season camps of the early humans because such a practice was observed from the Hadza and the Kung San. On the other side are scholars who feel the ethnographic data cannot be used for understanding past society as the two are totally different because present-day hunter-gatherer societies pursue or follow several other economic activities along with hunting and gathering, such as exchange and trade in minor forest produce or working as paid laborers in the fields of neighboring farmers. These societies are totally marginalized in all senses, geographically, politically, and socially. The conditions in which they live are different from those of early humans. Another problem is that there is a tremendous variation among living hunter-gatherer societies. There are conflicting data on many issues, such as relative importance of hunting and gathering, group sizes, or the movement from place to place. The role of women in contributing to the food supply in such societies cannot be denied. These factors ensures a relatively equal role for both men and women in present-day hunter-gatherer societies. While this may be the case study today, it is difficult to make such an inference from the past. That means we cannot really get what was there in the past. Okay, whatever we are studying, it is based on the present-day hunter-gatherer societies. But was it really practiced in the past? We are not sure. Okay, so with this, we came to the end of the chapter. So follow up for the next chapter. Thank you.